There are two types of bone that I want you to be familiar with. There's compact bone and spongy bone. And we're going to spend the majority of our time talking about compact bone, but before we get into the details of what makes up the compact bone, I want us to understand the difference between the two. But before we get into that, I want to talk about terminology. Anatomy, a lot of times, has many different names for the same thing. So as if you ever read a different textbook, I want you to be familiar with the different terms that can be used for the same thing. So when we're talking about compact bone, sometimes you can hear compact bone referred to as cortical or dense bone. And then in terms of spongy bone, you may hear the terms trabecular or cancellous. Now, a lot of times I will use the term trabecular because really this a type of bone is composed of trabeculae, or these tiny spicules of bone, tiny spines of bone. So let's look at an actual bone. So this is a, a femur that has been sectioned, sagittally sectioned, and it's really nice in terms of showing you the two different types of bone. So you can see what I'm talking about when I'm talking about these trabeculae, these little spines of bone right here. And this is going to be that trabecular or spongy bone. Whereas you can see this much denser compact bone. So really making up that, you know, strong portion of the diaphysis or the shaft of the bone. Now, differences between the two. Why are they located in different areas? Well, that compact bone is, as you would think, it's a bit more solid, so it's going to be really important in terms of resisting bending. And this is going to form the external layers of all bones. So even bones that are made up of almost exclusively spongy bone are going to have a layer of compact bone. So every single bone is going to have a layer of compact bone. Also important in terms of the bulk of the shafts or the diaphyses of all long bones. So you can see right here, this is compact bone and you'll have it in the majority of the long portion of long bones. Whereas spongy bone is going to be important in terms of strength, in terms of compression. So you'll have these in areas where you have joints. So on the ends of bones or these epiphyses, these are going to be made up of almost exclusively spongy bone, except for a small layer, like I was saying, of that compact bone. So right around here, even though the majority of this is made up of spongy bone, you're going to have compact bone on the edges. Now, these are going to contain larger spaces, and this is important for two main reasons. First, this really reduces the weight of the bone. If you think about it, if all bone was made up of compact bone or that heavier bone, we wouldn't be able to move as freely as we do. So it really reduces the weight. It also serves as protection of that red bone marrow or of yellow bone marrow. So remember in our previous presentation, red bone marrow is important in terms of blood cell formation. So really important in terms of protection of that. Now, where you're going to find spongy bone? The majority of your short bones, so your carpal bones are examples of short bones. Flat bones, so the majority of your skull cap or calvaria are composed of flat bones. And irregular bones, and the best example of irregular bones are your vertebrae, or the bones that make up your spinal column. And last but not least, these epiphyses, or these ends of long bones, are going to be made up of spongy bone as well.